Hello, my name is Vesa Juvonen, and in this demonstration, we will have a closer look on the remote provisioning technique, which is one of the new possibilities due to the improvements of the client-side object model in SharePoint 2013. This is let's actually start with an out-of-the-box SharePoint site and have a look on how the sub-site provisioning work natively without any customizations. So in SharePoint 2013, when you go to the site content and you click the new sub-site link, you are redirected to this application page, which is stored in the server side, which can be then used to create the sub-site. The templates, what we see here, are essentially out-of-the-box site definitions or custom site definitions or web templates which have been installed usually using farm solutions or full trust solutions, or optionally if you have actually saved site as a template or developed a custom web template which is deployed in a site collection level as a sandbox solution, those would be available here as well. So we are able to see those out-of-the-box theme site, blog project site, and community sites, and also a custom demo publishing site, which is a full trust solution. The challenge with this full trust solutions and actually the web templating system is, however, the significant amount of XML, which quite often needs to be deployed in a farm level. That's true in the site definition way. The only place where it's not true is the web templates which are deployed in a sandbox solution. But that brings additional complexity and brings additional considerations in a SharePoint farm, because now if we deploy our customizations as a farm level solutions, every single time we will do an update, or if we are fixing some bugs or whatever we do on the farm, there will be downtime also for the SharePoint. So not only for the customization itself, it wouldn't be away for a certain amount of time, but the SharePoint and accessing the content in SharePoint will be compromised as well. And that's not obviously a good thing, because that has a significant impact from a operational operational perspective. So long-term costs could be difficult. And also the web templates are, even though they are extremely powerful functionality and much, safer for the SharePoint farm than the site definitions, they do have their downside. So as an example, in the August cumulative batch, if there would be any improvements coming to the out-of-the-box team sites as a stapled features, those wouldn't be applied automatically to the web templates. So even though the web templates has been created based on the out-of-the-box theme site or out-of-the-box publishing site, those wouldn't be actually, the only XML has to be always tracked and updated whenever we are actually updating the SharePoint farm as well. And obviously that will have a maintenance cost impact. So one of the solutions is to start thinking at the provisioning engine and place that outside of the SharePoint. So getting rid of the feature framework, getting rid of the XML complexity within a SharePoint site in a way that we will never ever compromise the SharePoint, even though we would be actually updating our customization or the provisioning engine or the templating system. And the answer for that one is the remote provisioning engine. And what we have here is a custom solution, a custom provider hosted app, which is running in the on-premises. So in this case, I'm running this against my on-premises SharePoint. And since I'm running the stuff in a Visual Studio, this provider hosted application will be hosted in IIS Expression. Just as well, it could be hosted in on-premises IIS, or it might be hosted in the Windows Azure if you want to open up connectivity between the Windows Azure to your on-premises, or just as well to the Office 365. But it's a provider-hosted application, which means that the code is running outside of the SharePoint. And let's actually put this one, install that on the farm. So we do a deploy the application to the farm, And it is actually asking quite high permissions. It is asking the full control on the site collection, because we will use this application to create subsites. So we're managing the site collection hierarchy, so therefore pretty high requirements are asked. This wouldn't be a typical application or SharePoint app from a marketplace, because this is actually violating some of the marketplace rules, but it would be a completely fine solution as a in-house or as a manual, well, not manually, but outside of the marketplace installed SharePoint app to your Office 365 or to your on-premises. So let's install this on the SharePoint and let's see how the application actually changes the behavior of the functionality. So this is the application UI, but let's not actually concentrate on that one yet. So let's go back on the site. And what we did with the application, as part of the SharePoint app installation, we actually handled an app installed event. And within the app installed event, we used this technique called JavaScript injection, which essentially is based on JavaScript files within a SharePoint and a using of a custom action. And using this pattern, and I'll show that pretty soon in the code, we're able to do modifications in a host web. We definitely need to be careful of utilizing this technique, but it's an interesting option to bring additional capabilities available. Like in this case, we are actually updating the link, the new subsite link, to point not to the out-of-the-box application page, but rather to our provider-hosted app. So what it means is that now when the end user actually goes to the new subsite functionality and clicks the link, we are being redirected to the provider hosted application. So we're not actually within the SharePoint. Now we are running this the functionality actually outside of the SharePoint in the IIS application. In production environment, in on-premises, that would be a separate Windows servers load balance number. In Office 365, that could be then Windows Azure or just as well any other hosting environment. So we're running this provider hosted application now in IIS Expression, since this is a Visual Studio or development experience. And we are able to then enter the values, the selected kind of a familiar values when we are creating a subsite. So let's call this a subsite for root, and let's call the site sub. And then we are able to select the template. And these templates are essentially an abstractions of the out-of-the-box templates. So we do actually have an option to introduce multiple different variations of the theme sites. And let's have a look on that one pretty soon. But what we essentially do here is that we're able to now select, for example, the blog or theme site or community site. Let's create a theme site. And our application will start familiar working on it animation. So it feels like it's a native out-of-the-box SharePoint experience. And it will create the subsite or the site collection. And it will slightly modify the subsite based on the branding guidelines within this particular deployment. But essentially, the experience from an end-user perspective, it is exactly the same that we would be hosting this or using the out-of-the-box web templates or site definitions, because the end result is exactly the same. We're getting new subsites created based on the values and based on the given information. So now we have a new subsite created on the site collection, and there's actually some few more customizations. You can see that the branding has been applied. There's a meeting minutes document library included. There's actually a subsite automatically created for the team site. That's based on the configuration what we have. And again, if we want to create a subsite within this subsite, so if we further create sites within the subsite, we're able to again pinpoint the provider hosted application. So we're kind of using this JavaScript injection pattern and the provider hosted app and remote provisioning model, we're kind of taking over ownership of the subsite creation. So let's go back on the sites and have a closer look on the sites. As mentioned, when we selected that Contoso team site template, you can see that we created an out-of-the-box team site. But the out-of-the-box team site actually has a meeting minutes, and it also has a subsite called blogs. And that's to do our configuration. So within our code, the provider-hosted application is actually supporting XML-based configuration, just as well we could actually build a pretty complex UI on top of this configuration options, but this is a relatively, well, this is a proof of concept, so the UI doesn't anymore exist, or doesn't yet exist. But we selected the Contoso team site, and this is a customization or a provider-hosted application-specific configuration for individual templates. So we're actually able to now see that we do have four different templates configured in our provider-hosted application. And whenever the Contoso team site is selected, we are actually provisioning first out-of-the-box team site, which actually has a massive benefits, because now whatever changes will be introduced at the out-of-the-box team sites will be applied on these sites as well. But then we do something extra. We, for example, upload a few JavaScript files, and these are for handling the JavaScript injection. We create a custom action option, which is essentially making sure that that subsite link is overridden, and I'll explain that slightly later. We also provision a additional site, which is actually referring to the blog site, which is its own template. And we also create a list instance using a familiar feature framework-based XML configuration. But now we don't need to think about this anymore as a feature framework, feature XML, and the complexity of the on-net XMLs and all and done. The SharePoint doesn't actually need to understand any of this XML. The SharePoint doesn't have any customizations even deployed. What we do is that we use the client-side object model, essentially WCF or the web services to oversimplify things, to create the sites based on our configuration in this IIS application. So just to demonstrate the kind of a functionalities, let's actually create an alternative team site, and let's call this super team, and it's a super team site. It's better. So we'll do some small modifications. Let's actually add some additional things, like few document libraries, like presentations. Here we go. The template type is 101, which is the document library. Let's set the title presentations URL as presentations as well, and the quick launch URL, let's put that one there as well. And let's create also CVs. Let's call that just CVs. It's a location for storing CVs for the team, really just inventing this as we go. Anyway, we now have configured that whenever this template will be created, we will actually create a out-of-the-box team site. We'll customize that slightly to have a subsite, which is called a blog, created using the blog template. And we'll also create three different list instances to that site after the out-of-the-box team site template has been applied. So let's actually reapply and redeploy this, and just to make sure that we have that new template available, let's install the updated information. In real life, in production, obviously, we wouldn't have to trust whenever we redeploy, unless the permissions doesn't change. We don't need to do any changes on the host web. But as we can see now in this demonstration and in the development box, we are able to now say the super team. Let's go back on the root site. So if you go to the root site, we go to the site contents. One more time, the new subsite link is overridden. We use the JavaScript injection pattern to overread that one. And let's call this super cool site. And we are able to see that super team, which we just configured in our provider hosted application, which now the most important thing is running outside of the SharePoint. And we deployed this additional configuration to be available for SharePoint without any impact on the SharePoint availability. So all of the sites, all of the farm, all of the applications, everything, there was no behavior, no downside, downtime for the SharePoint itself. Yes, we did have to recycle the IIS application, the external application, but all of the natural, the out-of-the-box SharePoint functionalities were still all of the time available within the SharePoint. And let's create a new site, and let's see that it's actually working properly. So we're creating out-of-the-box theme site, and we'll slightly modify that to have a subsite called blog, and three different document libraries. That was meeting minutes, presentations, and CVs. And while we are executing that, we actually might want to have a closer look on what's happening on that JavaScript injection pattern. So let's come back on that one pretty soon. Oh, that was actually happened slightly more faster than I was expecting. But anyway, let's make sure that everything is fine. So if you go to the site contents, and we can see that from the navigation as well, we have the CVs, document library, meeting minutes, presentations there. We have the blog. We actually do also inject a new navigation entry on the left navigation that could be pointing, for example, to your corporate communication or intranet or whatever. And if you go to the new subsite functionality, there's actually a small bug in the code related on minimal download strategy, but now the new subsite link is again overridden to point to that provider hosted application. And how do we do that? Just to kind of show the real code behind of the whole thing. First of all, the configuration, what actually is handled and what's happening, that's read and analyzed by the page. So within the default ASPX in the code behind, we are offering those templates to be available, which are actually in the template in the our configuration, in the XML configuration. And actually pretty simple, whenever we start creating the subsites, we are taking that client context, and we do have then the custom create subsite functionality, which is essentially the one which is making sure that based on the particular selection from the end user, we are reading the XML, we're getting the site template, we are executing or adding the new web. And there we go, we're adding the new web to this particular context web. And then whenever the, and provisioning that, whenever the web has been actually provisioned, we are adding files, we're adding custom actions, list navigation nodes, provisioning subsites, whatever. And obviously this is completely, whatever we want to do, it's completely up to us. We can further enhance the functionality. From a demo's perspective, in this particular case, we always do hard-coded theming apply on the subsites. Just as well, we could actually upload a master page and apply that, but the theme is actually more flexible from a long-term perspective than master pages, and that's the reason why we are using themes in this example. But we're essentially making sure that the coloring is the same as in the host web. And this could be just as well configurable in the XML. But we're using the client-side object model, the classic functioning, for example, the creation of the subsite is just using the web creation information from our provider-hosted application, running outside of the SharePoint and making that happen. The second thing what I wanted to quickly also explain is how do we do that subsite link overriding, which is kind of debatable. Is it recommended? Just as well, we can actually access the create subsite functionality from our app icon. But if we want to provide for the end users the native kind of a feeling that we create subsites using the native out-of-the-box SharePoint experience, we currently need to do some JavaScript injection to make this happen. And what we do here is that as part of the application installation, we are actually injecting a one JavaScript on the site. We're using a custom action, which is essentially making sure that this JavaScript file is executed on every single time, on every single page on the site. And within the JavaScript itself, we actually have a pretty simple functionality. So essentially, we are trying to get the element ID called create site, create new site. That subsite creation link actually has a unique ID. And we update that unique ID to point to our provider-hosted application. At this point, it's hard-coded to point to this demo or proof of concept URL. Just as well, that could be a configurable entry which is exposed from external web service or whatever, if you want to have a one single location where the information is configured. So we can easily make it more flexible and configurable as well. But essentially, what we're doing is that within the HTML, let's actually have a look on that one. In the HTML of the page, in the that create subsite link actually has a unique ID, and we are pointing to that one, and we're updating that unique ID or the href link of that link with a unique ID to somewhere else. The key point to understand, however, on this one is that now that we do have a dependency on the create new site ID, this ID has been actually in a SharePoint since 2007, but we, as a Microsoft, we cannot guarantee that this wouldn't actually go away at some point. So we are actually kind of making an assumption that the create new site ID would be there in the future releases as well. But we are looking into providing more extensibility points on this one, and there will be more information obviously released slightly later. But that's how the custom action and the JavaScript injection actually works. So as part of the installation of the application, so let's have a quick look on that one as well. We handle the event, and in our event handling, we are actually uploading a JavaScript file and creating a user custom action to point to that JavaScript file. So as part of the execution of the page, we will always have that JavaScript file included there as well, which indeed has some small performance impact. But if you think about the overall amount of JavaScript in the SharePoint, that few lines of code really doesn't actually have that big of a deal or meaning from a performance perspective. And it provides us the capability of creating subsites and creating sites using completely custom templating system, which is actually providing us the really nice capability of getting rid of or reducing the feature framework dependencies. So now we can provide whatever kind of a templates using this provider-hosted application to the end users. From an end user perspective, functionality is the same. Select which template, and the site will be created. So most likely the end users wouldn't actually even notice that it's not their native SharePoint behavior, which is pretty cool. That's all we're going to do in this demo and quick demonstration on the provider-hosted the provider-hosted applications, the remote provisioning, and the JavaScript injection pattern. Concentration, obviously, on the remote provisioning and the model where we can remotely actually start creating these new sites and also providing templating system to replace the web template and site definition needs. And all of that customization, all we can achieve the custom specific UI templating system without any customizations deployed directly on the SharePoint as a feature framework element as a server side full trust code, which is pretty cool and pretty significant. That's all we're going to have a look on today, so thanks for your time.